Party Lines, Dance Music and the Making of Modern Britain, written and read by Ed Gillett. Introduction. This is a journey. Pick up most books which attempt to cover the full historical span of dance music, and you're likely to be told either implicitly or directly that they're the real thing, the authoritative text, the landmark history, the singular truth. This book is none of those things. It's a thread picked through a culture that's already been extensively catalogued and historicised over the last 30 years in an attempt to draw out themes and connections which others might have missed, or whose meaning might have changed in the decades since those definitive stories were first written, and to extend that perspective to more recent events. To take one small but illustrative example, plenty of early writing about dance music lauds the American anarchist Hakim Bey's theory of the temporary autonomous zone as a means to understand the revolutionary power of the rave. Bey's arguments sit far less comfortably now than in the 90s, partly due to his pen name, an uncomfortable piece of Middle Eastern appropriation for a white man born Peter Lamborn Wilson, but more importantly because of his unapologetic advocacy for paedophilia. Extracts from TAZ, The Temporary Autonomous Zone, were published by US paedophile group NAMBLA in 1993, alongside various other works focusing unambiguously on Wilson's sexual interest in children. The urge to view rave culture through Bey's lens takes on a very different set of connotations when you belatedly realise that the social strictures from which he was seeking autonomy include laws around the age of consent. The narrative thread connecting all of this is, at its simplest, a power struggle between our collective urge to congregate and dance, to lose and find ourselves on the dance floor, and the political and economic authorities which seek to constrain or commodify those messy and unstable desires. When I look at the history of UK dance music, it's this conflict I see underpinning everything, explaining how and why Britain's political and economic contexts have shaped dance music's form and function, and how rave has, in turn, played a critical role in moulding the Britain we inhabit today. Hopefully I'm not alone in thinking this way, but by definition and design, this is a subjective and partial perspective. Why should it be anything else? Of all the cultural disciplines to write about, dance music is perhaps the one most deeply shaped by personal experience. Literature, theatre, even recorded music. Each of these at least has some objective form from which we can derive and compare our own personal readings. But what is dance music without physical sensation? The pressure of sound from stacked bass bins, the tang of sweat in the air, the jostling of joyful bodies against yours. While some of this might be overstated, in particular the reliance throughout dance music history on the subjective experience of being on drugs, at some point you have to accept that the only way to truly understand dance music is to feel it, bodily and emotionally, rather than to understand it intellectually. Trying to muscle all of that into a piece of writing capable of being both universally understood and universally accepted would clearly be futile. Despite this, a canon has undoubtedly formed around the history of UK dance music. Two pieces of writing most responsible for that are the equally superb Energy Flash by Simon Reynolds and Altered State by Matthew Collin, to which I hope Party Lines might be seen as some kind of successor or response. In its simplest terms, and as laid out across those two books, the established narrative of UK dance music goes roughly as follows. House and techno are created in the black neighbourhoods of Chicago and Detroit in the mid-1980s, gradually spreading to DJs and dance floors around the world. But it's not until four British DJs, Paul Oakenfold, Danny Rampling, Nicky Holloway and Johnny Walker, go to Ibiza in the summer of 1987 and experience this new electronic music while under the influence of ecstasy, that things truly make sense. Returning to London, the clubs the Ibiza 4 set up, Future, Spectrum, Shoom and The Trip, mark the first spaces in which electronic dance music and ecstasy combine to form an entirely new cultural form, acid house. Over the next few years, UK dance music, mutating first from acid house into rave, then hardcore and jungle, rewires and revolutionises British culture, then that of the entire world. Its ballooning popularity sees it expand from basement clubs to vast illegal raves, a wave of mass civil disobedience which eventually forces the government to act. When they do so, with the Criminal Justice and Public Order Act 1994's infamous clampdown on repetitive beats, conventional retellings suggest that UK dance music's relevance as a political and cultural force is largely erased. Raving instead becomes a depoliticised and unthinkingly hedonistic leisure activity, of interest only for its shifting sonic and genre qualities, a mere background hum where once it was the heartbeat of the UK's counterculture. The opening chapters of Party Lines try to deconstruct some of these myths around rave's emergence and early years. Rather than treating the legendary journey of the Ibiza 4 and the subjective experience of being on MDMA as the twin sparks which ignite the rest of the story, it also looks at the critical and still largely under-acknowledged role of black sound system culture in setting out not just the core sonic influences for acid house, but also the social and political landscape which it would come to occupy. The sound system is just one of several such antecedents underpinning rave's prehistory, from the free festival movement of the 1970s to the moralistic policing of queer venues in British city centres in the 1980s. These each reveal UK dance music not as the spontaneous, unprecedented eruption it's so often depicted to be, bursting suddenly into rich colour against the bleak monochrome of the Thatcher years, but instead the direct and largely predictable evolution of cultural and political currents which cut across late 20th century Britain. Party Lines also looks to expand that narrative towards the present. Where previous retellings tend to lose some of their urgency after the Criminal Justice Act is passed, this book argues that the dance floor continued to be a highly political space, albeit serving diametrically opposed aims. The soft market economic policy and anti-black authoritarianism of the Blair governments, but also the burgeoning creative industries which came to include superclubs like Cream and Ministry of Sound. From there, these same forces of corporate capture and underground resistance run through pirate radio, broadcast and visual media, and struggles around urban space and gentrification, a process which ends in COVID-19's violent disruptions and the tentative re-emergence of more equitable possibilities for UK dance music stretching into the future. That's not to claim that these ideas are new or exclusive to me. While book-length overviews of UK dance music history still tend to gravitate towards those more familiar and widely accepted narratives, Party Lines also draws on a rich and growing history of writing which challenges and deconstructs those old assumptions, whether in academic work by Kojo Eschen, Paul Gilroy, Mark Fisher, Joy White, Julia Toppin, Caspar Melville, Lambros Fatsis, and many others, or in more genre-specific journalism and literature by Dan Hancocks, Emma Warren, Lloyd Bradley, Kieran Thapar, and Matt Annis, to name but a few. Party Lines is an attempt to synthesise several of these ideas, along with my own, into an overarching narrative which, while still inescapably partial and subjective, forms a coherent through-line tracing UK dance music's shifting political, legislative, and financial forms over the last 40 years. It's the story of power and money shaping how, where, and why we dance. The spaces we occupy, the sounds we hear, the people with whom we share the communal rituals of the dance floor, and the people to whom money and privilege accrue as a result. But it's also a story of how our collective desire to dance with each other has built modern Britain, its social hierarchies, cultural communities, capitalist structures, and legal restrictions. The seed for this story was first planted in a North London flat, meeting the artist Jeremy Deller for the first time before working together on his film Everybody in the Place. He explained his concept by loading up two YouTube videos. In one, silent images of the police baton charging the striking miners at Orgreave. In the other, the audio from the KLF's What Time Is Love, all apocalyptic synth stabs and pounding drums. It's a devastatingly simple juxtaposition. How could this dense, foreboding music have been produced in anything other than the crucible of post-industrial decline and authoritarian violence? If Everybody in the Place's connections between Thatcherite unrest and the birth of acid house was the starting point, then the end of the thread lay somewhere near housekeeping, a group of aristocrats, landlords and bankers posing as tech house DJs in the late 2010s, whose industry success laid bare the webs of power, money and influence coursing through the contemporary UK dance music scene, allowing those with privilege and access to get away with whatever they want. Party Lines is, in part, an attempt to work out how the former culture ended up producing the latter. There are undoubtedly going to be things I've missed in the process, whether through the limitations of the written word, the practicalities of managing such a vast story with tendrils stretching into so many different parts of British and political life, the shift in research focus between dancing at an illegal lockdown rave one day and battling the Metropolitan Police to release freedom of information data the next has at times been jarring, or just because of my own individual blind spots. I'm a straight, white, cisgendered man writing about cultures which, while not exclusive to or defined solely by the experiences of marginalised communities, are undoubtedly rooted in those injustices. What for me feels revelatory or totemic, proto-rave hippies listening to extended synth jams at Stonehenge, police and protesters battling in Hyde Park as the Criminal Justice Act passes into law, or the post-industrial sound and light spectaculars of the Warehouse Project might feel inert or peripheral to others. We all have our own dance music, the wordless rush of anonymous bodies pressed together in dark spaces, lonely nights spent in dimly lit bedrooms, pirate broadcasts emerging from the static, your first kiss in the drum and bass room at Fabric, the sun breaking over treetops in a distant, unfamiliar field, dry ice vibrating in the air in front of you as the speakers quake. Each of these moments tells a different story to each of us, every single one of them true. The particular story contained here just happens to be mine. My earliest experience of dance music, before all of the sweaty basements and the Arcadian fields, the lasers and bass bins and live streams, came from digging through my dad's CD collection as a curious child in the early 90s. One of the albums I first fell in love with was Coldcut's 70 Minutes of Madness, a frenetic DJ mix taking cues from the duo's late-night Kiss FM radio shows, swerving deliriously and deliciously between jungle, acid techno, breakbeats and ambient interludes, layered with vocal samples salvaged from the dustbins of 20th century cultural ephemera. It opens with an impossibly plummy voice, the post-war actor Jeffrey Sumner, taken from a 1958 LP demonstrating the then revolutionary technology of stereo sound, sampled previously on tracks by Eric B. and Rakim and Public Enemy. "This is a journey," Sumner intones, "which along the way will bring to you new colour, new dimension, new values, and a new experience," before his voice echoes away into nothingness and the beat drops. I hope Party Lines offers you something equivalent to that rather stiffly expressed sentiment, a sense of expansion and insight, evoking something which is both highly subjective and communally understood, the intuited experience and emotion of UK dance music's political and social history, brought into the light in a form of words which you and I can share. Chapter 1. Beat Down Babylon. Sound system culture, racism, and the roots of UK dance music. It is 4 a.m. on a Saturday in St Paul's, a neighbourhood northeast of the centre of Bristol, known for its sizeable Jamaican community. Deep bass tones throb through the walls of an otherwise unremarkable terraced house, with the sound of reggae and soul tracks cutting through the amorphous chatter of young voices. The year is 1973, a decade since the Bristol bus boycott brought systemic racism onto the British political agenda, and 7 years before St Paul's would explode into anger and rioting in response to aggressive policing and spurious raids on late-night music venues. Behind each of these struggles for political and social agency, the blues dance, loosely defined as an unlicensed all-night party held in a house or other impromptu space, catering almost exclusively to black audiences, more specifically Jamaican or at the very least Caribbean, formed an insistent bass-heavy soundtrack to the forging of black British identity and to the birth of UK dance music. The sonic debt owed by British electronic dance music to black culture and experience is clear and inarguable, from Acid House's frantic rewiring of sounds created in the queer black clubs of Chicago, to jungle, garage and grime's stylistic inheritance from dub and reggae. Less regularly discussed are the connections between wider legislative policing or economic pressures affecting black British lives between the 1950s and the 1980s, and the forms subsequently taken by UK dance music. From immigration and housing to employment and stop and search, the socio-political forces which first collide in the blues dance create the conditions from which global multimedia brands, lavish superclubs, and illegal warehouse raves alike would ultimately be formed. The story of dance music stretches across ethnicities, cultures, and identities, and race is not the only lens through which we can view it. However, to fully grasp the complex interweaving between dance music, political power, and social history, Britain's complex relationship with race and racism has to be placed front and centre. One of the young black men crammed into this small Bristol house is the sociologist Ken Price, who is attending to covertly gather research material for his PhD study into the lifestyles, attitudes, beliefs and behaviours of West Indian communities in Bristol, later published in 1979 as Endless Pressure. Having been subsumed into the throng, he will go on to provide one of the first written descriptions of what the blues dance looks, sounds, smells and feels like from the inside. On being let into the party, he joins a dense, teeming, sweaty mass of humanity, shrouded in weed and tobacco smoke. The atmosphere is shadowy, but undeniably sensuous. Attendees lean their heads and watch, laughing and talking.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.